We turn next to the next public hearing. Madam Clerk?
Next public hearing, receiving opinion, is public hearing 2012-0407, reference to group free petition under City Charter Section 9-1, paragraph B, which requests an additional public hearing concerning commercial street of Calhoun Lake District, which was approved by City Council May 2012.
Before I open the public hearing, state by City Clerk, I'd like to call the city's general counsel to the podium. Please, excuse me. And I'd like to ask that you address the city council on how the council, under Section 9-1B, may act as required by Section 9-1B. This presentation by the city attorney based on your memos of city council dated July 17th. Do you mind being managed to write it?
Do you like to read the chat?
So anybody here to hear it?
The memo states, "This is in response to request and opinion regarding the legal effect of the petition filed by the city clerk's office on May 7th, 2012. Petition states, in pertinent part, we need the undersigned roster of the skill that on the city council meeting plan for May 8th, 2012, the decision of the Calhoun District Commercial Street and Pavilion Street is not sufficient for subject of this magnitude. Invoking city regulations to hereby request an additional public hearing for this council to follow up on the subject. Handwritten at the top of the petition, which states, RB, Charter Section 9-1. The city clerk has certified that the petition was signed by the 150 voters. The city charter at Section 9-1A requires that the city council shall hold a public hearing and act with respect to every petition which is addressed to it and which is signed by the 150 voters."
Excuse me, could the speaker use the microphone so we could hear?
I'm sorry. I'll start at the beginning of the second. The city charter at Section 9-1 provides the city council shall hold a public hearing and act with respect to every petition which is addressed to it and which is signed by the 150 voters. The council has properly noticed the public hearing on the petition for July 24th, 2012. The sole issue before the council is the request for an additional public hearing on the hotel or the lake district in the proposal. However, General Law Chapter 40A, Section 5, says that the legislative process to which a proposed amendment is enacted. The council strictly follows this process. The amendment was referred to the planning board and the planning and development committee. The planning board held a public hearing on the amendment and made its recommendation to the city council and the requisite number of days. The board held numerous sessions on the issues. Every session of planning and development committee was present, which then held its own series of public meetings on the amendment. The committee forwarded its recommendations along with the planning board's recommendations to council. The council held a notice of public hearing and voted to enact the amendment. With regard to its ability to enact the amendment, the council is required to hold a public hearing on... With regard to its authority to enact the amendment, the council is limited by the statutory authority set forth in General Law Chapter 40A. The council is required to hold a public hearing on the petition requesting an additional public hearing. However, under the zoning act, any public hearing would be moot as the zoning amendment is no longer before the council. Therefore, there is no legal basis upon which an additional public hearing can be held. With regard to the zoning amendment, there is no action that the council can take.
Thank you, Susanna. To sum it up, we're here this evening not under Chapter 40A as a zoning amendment. However, the part of the city charter allows free petition under 9-1B. That's the umbrella under which we can hold public hearings this evening.
of the issue of enacting the hotel overlay zoning district is no longer before the council because you're acting on that. So what is the board council is whether or not an additional public hearing should be held, as requested at the end of the petition.
Thank you. What I'm going to do is open a public hearing under 9.1b of the city charter with the understanding that the council has no authority to reopen the zoning map commercial street with the HOD. The public hearing this evening, there's a lead speaker that would like to speak in favor of the petition and present it to the city council. We have up to 15 minutes to make a presentation to the city council, the lead speaker. How many people are in the audience this evening that are planning on speaking to the issue? How many people are planning on speaking to the issue? 2, 3, 4. Okay, we will allow up to 3 minutes each, and we're going to already public hearings. We could divide this in one, so we would, but I have a problem speaking to 3 minutes each to hear from others aside from the speaker. I'm asking you, those who are in favor of petitions that were sent and plan on speaking, if you please stand in line on the left hand side of this, so we know who's identified with the SPD. Would you please stand and go behind the podium if you plan on speaking for 3 minutes? Anyone else? So we have 1, 2, 3. The first person in line, the lead speaker, the lead speaker for 15 minutes?
I'll be sure of that.
Okay, because we have no public comment, we have this topic referred to committee, other than the planning and development, we refer it back to the city council. There's no action. So there's no committee report that we're coming forward. So we have questions by the city council. When the public hearing is called, there's a discussion by the city council. But we're acting here this evening under the realization that we're acting under 9.1d, not the zoning ordinance. Not 1.1 of all the zoning ordinance and not 40A of the state. Yes, it is the same law. Does anybody have any questions as to what the program is this evening? Okay, we have the lead speaker. We have up to 15 minutes to make your presentation. And there will be time for the opposition to also speak if there are anyone in the audience. Please take a position at the podium and state your name and address for the record. Can you hear me?
How's that?
Good.
Rhonda Kendall, 44 Ford Square.
Sorry?
Rhonda Kendall, 44 Ford Square. For businesses, residents, and supporters requested this hearing primarily because the initial hearing on this issue was clearly unanimous even before it occurred. Our concern was that voting would take place without the city council taking time to read the written testimony that was turned in, and indeed that is exactly what I've been asked by two groups, Hold the Fort and Citizens for Boston Harbor, to speak on their behalf of our concern about the integrity of the City Council's process regarding the hotel overlay district vote thus far, and to ask you to take the opportunity to set this right. It's our impression that City Councilors, led by the Council President, have shown no concern or interest in what their constituents have to say. It's become increasingly clear that the City Council is merely going through the motions of holding public hearings. At the deciding vote on May 8th, most of the councilors delivered speeches that were obviously written prior to the vote being taken. Remarkably, one councilor testified that she was voting based on input from her constituents, when in fact, when that input was reviewed after public records request, in fact, it revealed that the majority opposed the proposed zoning change. We spent hours of our time, hundreds of dollars of legal counsel, and benefited from new information, shadow studies, and expert testimony. There were far more people opposed to the rezoning than in favor of it. Nevertheless, instead of continuing the hearing, and may moderate our political process. Based on what we observed in the email exchange revealed in the days preceding tonight's hearing, we know that our representatives are not representing us. In fact, the three that I communicated with personally, none knew anything about it, through no fault of their own, I must say. The matter was handled almost entirely by the city's legal counsel. And now, of course, the whole is scary by newspaper's reaction to the outrageous plan to open and close the hearing without testimony. Our representatives have held the meeting. The process was insulting and painful. The police presence at the last meeting was humiliating and impeded discussion and interfered with the democratic process. Being cut down to 2 and then 1 minute, they are attempting to convey our information and points if possible. The planning board passed everything over to the city council, and the council passed most of everything off the special permit process without doing the research that was needed. We did a lot of research on our own. We had experts, we had studies, and submitted many, many documents that showed how the hotel overlay district would not fit into this area. But they remained in the box, never being seen at the time of the vote. Two of the most important things that were not seen are as follows. We submitted studies showing the adverse effects of putting public on our business by another community. In writing today, we had Davis has plans to develop property that he didn't even own yet, and filed so many lawsuits against those who own the property that forced them out of that site. These are the tactics that he used the last time he wanted to acquire some land, and there are two big factors that should be taken into consideration in the decision-making process. Some other issues are the safety issues. Engineering issues were valid because they are in the hotel overlay district and should have been allowed to be presented later on. Truck issues, as Attorney Mark Point Clarity brought up in regards to companies threatening to stop delivery of products at commercial street. The Newport study that showed the tax revenue was higher for water-dependent businesses than from other industries, things like this. It was sad and illustrative that the process in this room had two distinct sides that required one side from another to become very representative of how the city has been divided by the way this process has been handled. It was unnecessary and it was divisive, and it wasn't conducive to a good conversation and learning. It's of interest to quote notice that the back shore hotel overlay district hearings may be conducted in a different way. I don't know if the police have been called into notice of it. The credibility of the city council has been damaged. It can be restored through repeated vote of May 8th and conduct a thorough process, including the public hearing and the discussion of all the issues that were raised and revoked. Short of taking these steps, there's really nothing further to say. For the public, even those who are in favor of the proposal now, will know that the city council roster has not represented its people. Thank you.
While all the presented material were being unread. Clearly, the system needs to be fixed. So I am using this time to not deal with the zoning issue. I'm using my 3 minutes to help restore the democratic process of the city of Gloucester. In theory, if you go back to the Declaration of Independence with perhaps the world's most famous phrase, we hold these truths to be self-evident. But the actions of the city council have shown that they are not self-evident. The only thing that is self-evident is that our representatives have not been representing us. Melissa Fox, for the record today in the paper, said that, quote, she wasn't aware of the petition until after the May 8th meeting. But email documents show that on May 7th, the day before the meeting, our board council stated that she didn't know if we had 150 signatures necessary for the second hearing that we needed, that as per our request. She also recommended, in a way which causes a question of motivation, that we not present the petition of 150 signatures for more, and not even present it at that meeting of May 8th, but to even not present it until the following meeting. When asked through the public records law for the full revelation of the emails, our ward counselor claimed that 10 days, as allowed by law, was too little to provide all the documents needed. Given that the first request for those documents was May 9th, it took over 2 months for those requests to come through, in complete disregard of the requirements as set forth by the state. But my First Amendment rights are not. The governments are instituted to arrange men to rise in their powers from the sense of government. And whether any form of government becomes destructive.
For purposes of the rules of the council, I would note that the council president allowed 15 minutes to the lead speaker, which was not given in 3 minutes for the substance of the meeting. I would ask that the second speaker, as a matter of courtesy, be allowed to balance the time to the second
right.